5. So this topic is so important. And why do you think it's important? Because see, our thinking produces our attitude towards life. So our thinking is so important because everything that we have to do in life will come through thinking. Therefore, how we think is important. You will hear over and over again about attitude. I'll be talking about attitude because see, thinking will produce attitude, and our attitude will be reflected on the outside. So this message is designed to explain to you how you can shape your thinking. So this series of messages is to help us to shape the way we think. So this illustration is geared towards thinking, how we think. Remember the dictionary explanation of attitude that will help us to understand thinking. So the dictionary defines attitude as the way a person feels life. So the way you feel life will reflect on what you think about life. So then it will affect your intellect, your emotions, your will. So all this will come together to shape the way we approach things or issues in life. So it's a position or bearing that indicates feelings, words, and actions. So an inward feeling expressed by outward behavior, the inward thinking reflecting on the outward. That is thinking, and that is attitude. A reflection of the person inside, the reflection of the man inside. So our soul, where all these things are taking place, with those chambers, our mind, where we have our thinking, where we have our intellect, you know, in a place where we have our listening capability, where we listen about issues. You see this, you look at this, you hear this, and then you begin to listen. And then your listening capability in your mind, you begin to reflect on how you approach those issues in life. For as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Now, as we keep physical memoir in life, a kind of historical journal in life, or biography in life, as we keep that, as we keep and you jot down all those activities that you have engaged in your life, also that kept in our soul a kind of spiritual memoir whereby all that we are doing, everything, however small it is recorded so that we'll give account of this in that day, the day of judgment. And that is the reason why for every Christian, we need to understand that there is an opportunity for us and there is a great importance for us to develop the way we think so that it can reflect according to the Word of God. It can be shaped according to God's commandments so that by the time we shall stand before God, we shall stand blameless. So it's so important. Look at Matthew chapter 12, Matthew chapter 35 to 37. He said, a good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. But I say to you that for every idle word men may speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment. Just idle word, a simple word. So God is keeping that memoir in our heart. It's recording those things we are saying. It's recording every activity. I told us that our soul will never die. Our soul will continue to exist in life. It will not die. But the issue is, after we will have left this body, where our soul resides, where are we going to continue to exist? Or where are we going to continue to live? The decision that you have made or you will make inside this body will determine where your soul will continue. If you have given your life to Jesus Christ, you have accepted Him as your personal Lord and Savior, then your soul will continue in a place of peace. We continue with Him where there is life forevermore. And for anyone who refused to accept Christ as his personal Lord and Savior, such a person's soul will continue in a place prepared for Satan, the other fallen angels, a place of sorrow, a place of pain forever. That will not be your portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So our soul will continue. God is keeping all that we are doing, all the activities are being kept, recorded in His own memoir, so we cannot, you know, manipulate it. The record is perfect. The record is accurate. Because what a man sow, that he will reap. You will not take my record, neither will I take your record. God is taking notice of every one of us. Verse 37 says, "For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned." So when do you think your words are being produced? Your words are being produced from your mind, the thinking. Because as man thinks, so is he. So all that you are reflecting on the outside, those things were concluded in the inside, in your mind. And that is why it is important that we take notice of the way we think. We should shape the way we think so it can be in accordance with the words of God. Proverbs 4:23. Thinking is so important, then you have to guard your heart, which means you have to guard your mind. You have to guard your soul, where all these activities are taking place. Proverbs 4:23. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. All issues of life. All issues of life spring from our soul, from our heart, from your mind. Everything you do, the beginning of what you do is right inside your heart, your mind. That is why Jesus said, because you are thinking of it, you are already done it. Even if you are not acting it outside, because when you are thinking of it in your heart, it is concluded. So if you have the opportunity, you will act it, you will do it. So it is wise therefore to guard our heart. Because out of our heart, we have everything to do with life springing out. Proverbs 23 verse 19. Proverbs, my son, and be wise, and guide your heart in the way. Guide. Now that is different from guard your heart. So when you guard your heart, like they said in that 4:23, keep your heart. It means we are keeping it, we are protecting it. Now when you guide your heart, it means you are tailoring it. You are controlling it. You are leading it. You allow your heart to be led according to the searchlight in God's word. Mark 7:21, for from within out of the heart of men proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders. From the heart of man, from your mind, all these things are being cooked from that place before you now present it on the outside. So God gave instructions to His covenant people, the Israelites. So Deuteronomy 4:9. Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 9. And diligently keep yourself, lest you forget the things you know your eyes have seen, and lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life, and teach them to your children and your grandchildren. Which means that Those things we have heard in God's word has to continue to be developed in our mind, in our soul, our heart, so that we can live a worthy life. And that is the only time, according to that place, that is the only time that God will be happy with them. The only time they can keep the covenant, as man thinks. So let's see some basic facts or principles about thinking. Let's see some of them and then give you some few advice and we are ready to go. The pattern of thinking. So our pattern of thinking as Christians is so important. So if you shape your pattern, you form a module of thinking as a Christian, and then you enforce it in your life. If you shape it and you prepare the model according to God's words, and then you enforce it, you will have results. You will have great results. This is not a magic. You prepare a particular pattern. And this is what I'm going to do. When I'm faced with this, I'm going to approach it this way. And that pattern is in accordance to the laid down rules and God's commandments. The result will be obvious. And you can repeat that over and over again. So people that their pattern of thinking results in negative attitude towards life or towards learning, for example, generally do not learn much. If you have a pattern, of thinking or model that is so negative and lukewarm, very complacent towards learning, those kind of people generally do not learn much in anything. They will not have the fuel or the momentum to learn. Your attitude at the start of a task, your attitude at the start of a particular project will affect the outcome of that project. Will affect the result. If you have the thinking that you cannot do something, for example, if that is your thinking, you will develop the attitude that you won't be able to do it. And the coaches in sports, they know this very well. They want people that have the attitude that I can do it. People that will pattern their thinking towards it is possible. Yes, I can do it. Not people that will say I cannot or it is not possible. It is difficult. This is too hard for me. So people like this, the coaches don't want them. They want people that have the willingness to practice, willingness to be disciplined, willingness to push beyond limit. Willingness to do things even when it is hard. Coaches, they love people like this. So in the world of sport, this is so important and preeminent. All is well that begins well, you know that. And also all is well that ends well. So if you have the attitude that it's well, whatever I do, I leave my hands upon, let me continue to go, however hard it is, and you pattern your life towards that, you will achieve so much. So momentum, the momentum development, the drive to do something lies inside your thinking. The momentum you generate from the fact that you are thinking that it is possible, I'm going to do it. Such a momentum is developed when your thinking is positive towards a task, and then the task will be completed. Because there is a drive, there is a momentum generated, there is a force. And then you'll be able to achieve it. And let me give you this simple illustration about my life. This will drive this point home. A pattern of thinking. I don't know what you're facing right now. But if you shape your pattern of thinking in such a way that you begin to develop negative attitudes towards a task, towards a business, towards a profession, towards a family, I will tell you, the result is very clear. There's no magic about it. It's titanic. When I finished my high school, so in Africa, we call it, high school, secondary school, you finish secondary school, I finished my high school, the first job I would get was a bank clerk. Bank clerk, I love it, I was so happy. Put on tie, suit up, get to the office, But there's something that happened that gave me very lukewarm attitude towards accountancy profession. It's a good profession, wonderful profession. As a clerk, I was so good at the job that even the manager of the bank would give me the key to the strong room where they keep the money. That's how much I was trusted. I would take the key to the strong room to my house. I was so young then, I didn't know it was not even good to do that. Because somebody can, cross me on the road, get the key from me, and go back and maybe get some gangs and rob the bank. And I'll be in trouble. But, it's just like, oh, they love me. So I will keep the key, bring it back. Several times, they will give me the key to the strong room. They will, I will be rotated to all the divisions, all the departments in the bank. They love me so much. So the bank manager and the accountant in the bank, they thought that, because I keep telling them I have to go to college, they thought when I go to college, I'm going to study either banking or accountancy. But do you know what put me off? What affected my pattern of thinking towards that? Is balance sheet, to balance. Every time and on Friday, we have to balance. We have to balance our account. You, those of you that are accountant, you understand what I mean. By that time, I will use this. You may be looking for one cup, one cent. You cannot pick 1 cent from your purse and have to eat. You continue to look. So if you can balance on Friday, then you have to come on Saturday to balance. Just to balance. You can take your hours. Sometimes you will have somebody to come and help you. I don't like that. How will I be looking for a money that is not lost? You have to balance it. Because it's going to come up. In their something. So that really put me off in accounting. So when I told them I'm going to college, I told them I'm going to study engineering, they said, what? You are going in banking. I said, that's what I want to study, engineering. Even when I came into this country and I went to graduate college, the program that I did, I have to do what they call core courses, capstone courses, and electives. One of the core courses they said we have to do with all the core courses in Master of Business Administration, MBA, and Managerial Accounting and Financial Accounting are part of those core courses I have to do. And this is science. This is science. So I went to my advisor. I told him, look, I am an engineer. I'm doing these things and I don't think I will need accountancy. I mean accounting, managerial accounting or financial accounting. Can I just take some electives so I cannot say no? You got to do it. I said, you will need it somehow in life. But I said, but in this profession, I don't think I'm going to say, it's a purpose, you got to do it. You see me here? You see me now? I did it. I had a pattern that I don't like it. I don't want to do it. But because I want to get the degree, I just did it. That pattern that I developed, even when I was so young in the first job, even affected me to that level. So, when we have such a pattern that we cannot do something, we will lose the interest to do it. So, as a Christian, don't let us conclude and form a pattern that will be so negative to a particular issue, to the level that we will lack the interest or the energy to do that thing. Pattern of thinking. We need to think all the time. We need to reflect on how we think. If you had concluded on something and said, forget it. This is, I can't do this. It's going to be hard. Even God will not want to force you to do it. Let's begin to review the way we think. Because as man think in his heart, so exactly that man is the product of his thinking. Your thinking, number two. Your thinking as a differential factor in opportunity and problem. Your thinking as a differential factor in opportunity and problem. Now, this is what I'm talking about. Are you with me this afternoon? As man thinks, it's what we are dealing with. Your thinking that produces your attitude towards life could turn obstacles or problems into blessings. Obstacles. If your thinking as a differential factor in opportunity and problem. If your thinking is such that When you see opportunity, when you see a problem, you see opportunity in that problem, I want to tell you, even in any problem where we have opportunity, what you will see is the opportunity. And in the opportunity, in any opportunity where we have problem or challenge, what you will see is not the challenge. You know, you will skate through the challenge, you will overcome the challenge, you will see the opportunity in that situation. Your thinking helps differentiate the difference between a problem and opportunity. Your thinking. How you think in your soul will help you to differentiate between a problem and an opportunity. The same scenario that may be a problem to somebody can be an opportunity to you if you can think straight and think right and think positive. Last week, the first NBA final was played on the 5th of June. Where the stadium where they used, I think in San Antonio, at a point in time, the AC went off. It became a problem. Now, do you know that to Miami Heat, that was a problem. It was a great obstacle for them. But to San Antonio Spurs, it was an opportunity. They were swearing towards the end. They were swearing. And it was so hard. The condition was very, very uncomfortable for them to play basketball. But they keep swearing. And they beat Miami Heat by 110-95. First NBA final. What was a problem to Miami Heat was an opportunity to San Antonio Spurs. And they seized the opportunity. At the end of the game, they interviewed one of the players. He said, oh, in Europe, maybe he came from Europe. He said, in Europe, we play in stadium without air condition. So it's like, come on, this is not a problem, it's an opportunity. And they keep swearing. Do you understand? In NBA final, to beat Miami Heat 110-95, they seized the opportunity when Goliath was swearing, was thinking, I'm going to do this. Saw it as a problem. But David saw it as an opportunity. So it depends on what you are thinking or how you are thinking. What is a problem to somebody can be an opportunity for you to soar, to succeed. So it depends on how you think. And this is why this topic is so important. Don't just rule it out. And this is very simple. I don't need to know this. You need to know this. So that when opportunity beckons on you, you must be able to know it when you see it. And you must be able to seize that opportunity. Because it may be the only opportunity you have. They say opportunity comes but once. You may not have the opportunity again. And that was what happened to this NBA final last week. Because they won't let that happen again. To be in a stadium without air condition, they will not let it happen again. But for that period, nobody's going to wait and say, let's cancel the match and let's go repair. They don't even know what happened. But San Antonio Spurs seized the opportunity and they saw it. Whereas the Miami Heat saw it as a problem and they were defeated. By how many points? 10 points, 110-95. Are you with me this afternoon? That is why it's generally said in life. If life gives you lemons, make lemonade. But that is not possible. If life is giving you lemons to make lemonade, if your thinking is not geared towards God's word and thinking positive. Because when life is giving you lemons, you know what some people be doing? They will say they are the worst in life. Why am I like this, God? What did I do wrong, Lord? I think I'm doing everything right. They will look at it as if the whole world is coming down on them, not knowing that for your life to be giving you lemons is an opportunity for you to make lemonade from it. It's not have to do with the way you think. Have the right attitude towards life. Inside every opportunity, there is a problem. Believe me. And also, there is an opportunity inside every problem. It depends on what you are looking. It depends on how you are thinking. Your thinking gives you uncommon perspective attitude. And uncommon perspective attitude gives you uncommon achievement in life. Your thinking will give you uncommon perspective. If life is giving you hard, you eat it hard. It's your thinking. So you can have uncommon results. When it's becoming so hard and it's becoming so much difficult and it seems as if it's going to be an insurmountable issue, you now, you also, you guide your lungs. You said, I'm going to defeat this one. This one's not going to defeat me. All has to do with the way you look at life and the attitude you have towards such a situation from your thinking. When you give up at life, you have no strength to continue. And the future is going to be so bleak. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
See, at conversion. And see, I just want to explain this to us because it's something we need always in life. We need this always in life. Because the way you process, that's why they call it in our thinking. You know, in your soul, where you have your mind, you have your emotions, you have your will. In that your soul, right in your mind is the envelope. Your mind is the envelope where you protect all the aspects of your soul. I have told you before, and this is very important. Your mind is the envelope. That is where you vibrate your attitude towards life. That is where you produce your attitude towards life. In your mind, where the thinking is taking place. That's why they call it, they say intelligent quotient. The way you listen, your listening capability, so important. Can you imagine those 12-year-olds, those 12-year-olds? How can you read something on the internet? They said there's somebody called Slenderman. Vision, something that is not real. That if you can do the unthinkable, stab somebody to death or something like that, then the Slenderman will promote you. The Slenderman will give you a palace. The Slenderman. And they brought out on the webpage of that those organizations, one tall image with a little child, and the Slenderman is slender like that too. Well, the Slenderman himself is not enjoying. But how do you think that when you do that, you're gonna enjoy? Where will the enjoyment come from? Now you see the listening, you see the thinking. But I am not condemning. Anyone who is exposed to the environment where peace is taught, where living in harmony is taught, where evil is condemned, where righteousness is promoted, where holiness and godliness is enhanced, we don't want to do that. I'm telling you. We don't want to do that. Your exposure. And that's why it is said that it is from childhood that you form so many of these thinking patterns. You develop so many of these thinking patterns in your childhood. And when you now grow to an adult, it's now a matter of choice. And that is why you need to continue to recalibrate your mind according to the words of God. You get exposed to the environment that we encourage you to treat people nicely. That we encourage you to do to others what you want others to do to you. Golden rule. You want to stab somebody that is your friend. You know that stabbing will kill that person. You don't want to do that if you don't want somebody to do that to you. And I mentioned it enough. One of them slept over. And that's another problem. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I'm preaching, but when I have something to say, I want to say it. I don't know if you believe in that. I don't believe in sleepover. I don't believe in it. If you are my child, what I have, you should enjoy it. If you think that over there is better, you don't have choice. See, there are some things we can choose. I didn't choose my parents. I didn't choose my country. I didn't choose my race. God did all those things for me. And I believe that what God has given me is the best. My parents are the best. My country is the best. My station, my the way I look, the way I, that's what God, that's the best thing. God is saying I am wonderfully and I'm beautifully made. So if you think that you sleep over there before you can have fun, begin to change that pattern of thinking. If you want to be in harmony with me as my child, because we go to battle. I'm telling you, I'm not going to leave it like that. I was telling some people, when my child was, when some of my children, when they were teenagers, because I want to monitor all this email going in and out, I put a filter. I didn't let them know. I didn't let them know. All their email I was reading. Sometimes I'll ask them some questions, they will go and show their passport. And associate your passport, you are still a minor. The filter will tell me the new passport, I will hack into your, yes, because you are a minor. You are a minor. I will hack into your email account, I will read everything. So where you are going, I quickly go before you go there. Because the teenager don't want to change the world. They believe these old school people. They know better than them. They can do better. They can do this. But it's not true. Look at this 12-year-old. What do you think they know? What? See them now, they're not going to be shy as adults. And I don't know how many years they're going to give them. You see that now? And this can be prevented. I'm not condemning their parents. It's hard to be a parent without God's help. It's hard. I'm not condemning them, but I'm saying that cross your T's, dot your I's. God will ask you. Amen?
Amen.
If you like, encourage sleepover. The Lord will help you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Your compassion does not change your thinking automatically. That's what I'm saying. When you, the day you gave your life to Christ, your compassion will not change your thinking. So you have to continue to, develop. You have to continue to renew your mind. How's the Bible put it in Romans chapter 12 verse 2? You got to renew your mind. The attitude you develop from your thinking is not automatically good simply because you are a Christian. Simply because you are a Christian, don't think that now I'm a Christian, I must be a good person. Even when they had Jesus Christ, there is a good man. He said, nobody is good except God. Nobody is good except God. And that's why you have to watch out. You have to be very vigilant. You have to guard your heart. You have to guide your heart. It's so important you put all these things together. Rather, your thinking is a choice you make. It is an attitude from a deliberate step you take in your thinking. It's a cause that will produce effect. Just because you became a Christian does not mean your attitude will change immediately. So you must decide to change it from your thinking. You change the way you see things. You change the way you act to things. You change the way you attend to things. You change the way you look at things. And that's what that Romans chapter 12 verse 2 is saying. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may prove that what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Transformation comes not by trying, but by training. Tell somebody, transformation comes. Not by trying, but by training. Let me give you this also illustration, this life illustration. One elderly man came from Africa, a friend, he was in his 60s, and then he took up, just for a while, just to get some little money, just not to be so lazy, he took a good decision. He took up a job, a security job, somewhere in downtown. But they gave him night. So one night, so that place, I visited him one time, it was a very good place, quiet, but very tempting. You can sleep off. You think nobody's going to see you. It's like a receptionist. Just sit down looking. That's it. From night, then the morning, it closes. So one day, he didn't know, those people are not fools. They also monitor you. So one day, they met him sleeping. So when they caught him sleeping, the next day, they said he should come to the office. So he said when he got to the office, they told him, sleeping on duty is not acceptable here. And he told them, I will try not to sleep. They said, no, 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 we are not talking of trying. This is a last chance. Not trying. You just have to not sleep. You must not sleep. We are not paying you to sleep. We are paying you to do what? To work. The employer said, well, don't not try. You just have to. Now, when you think that trying is okay, trying is not okay. Training, you just have to train your mind the way you think. Just have to train your mind the way you attend to things. Just have to train your mind the way you do things in life. They will not accept trying. Most of them will say, well, I'm trying. You're not trying anything. You just have to train yourself and do the right thing. It has to come, transformation has to come not by trying, but by training. We have to train our mind, that's what that place is saying, and do not conform, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You have to renew your mind, and it's not something you graduate from. It's every day you continue to do it. You never stop to renew your mind until you pass out, until you see God in glory. Do we stop thinking? We never stop thinking. Did anybody stop thinking? That is it. He will go and meet the Lord and continue his thinking there. Because your soul will never die. Amen. Amen. It's just a transition. So, no perfect attitude, since human beings are not perfect. And that is the reason why we just have to continue to work on our thinking. No perfect attitude, no perfect thinking, because God is not, only God is perfect. So when you expose your mind into God's word, that is when you can come out with a very good attitude towards life. Positive one, positive thinking, when you expose yourself to God's word. And that's why it's good to read the Bible. It's good to come to church to fellowship. In fact, the Bible recommended that we should not forsake the fellowship of each other. Because iron will sharpen iron. We have to do this all the time. So we have a tool which is very important to continue to develop. Very important. And that is what we have in Psalm 119, verse 5 to 15. Psalm 119, from verse 5 to 15, what we had in our Bible reading this morning, this service. Because see, we have to continue to develop our mind. Don't leave it on. See, an idle mind is the workshop of Satan. You must keep your mind active. You continue to develop your mind. And there's no time you cannot develop your mind. I've heard that someone went to school at age 70, I think about 70, to be a medical doctor. At 70. So because your mind, it is you. It's you. Even if you become a old man, now look, I was an old man. I'm still thinking I'm a teenager. I'm not a old man. You think somebody is old? No. It's in the mind. Amen?
Amen.
I was talking to somebody today. We were just talking over there. And he was telling me what he did this morning. And, you know, I was kind of talking that way, you know, the way we do things when we were like, you know, our 20s. If we do the same thing now, at this age, we may not. But see, it still has to do with our mind. And that is why you renew your mind all the time and make it fresh. You calibrate it all the time and make it ready to work. You can do it. Psalm 119 from verse 5, it says, "All that my ways were directed to keep your status, then I will not be ashamed when I look into all your commandments. I will praise you with upright of heart when I learn your righteousness judgments. I will keep your status, oh, do not forsake me utterly." How can a young man cleanse his way? How can a young man renew his mind? How can a young man think straight? Look at what he says here. "By taking it according to your word, with my whole heart I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments." When we allow God's word to develop in our heart, we will have the right thinking, the right attitude towards life, and we will love the Lord more and more. Look at verse 11. It says, "Your word have I hidden in my heart, that I may not sin against you." When God's word is in your heart, then sin will be far away from you. Satan will not like somebody like you. When you allow God's word to be in your heart, He will think twice before approaching you, because He knows it's going to be tough. You not give it a single opportunity. Verse 12. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your status. With my lips have I declared all the judgment of your mouth. I have rejoiced in the way of your testimonies. As much as in all riches, I will meditate on your precepts and contemplate your ways. Where are you going to be doing that? In your heart, in your mind, thinking about God's word, thinking about God's, you know, assignments. As man thinks, as we think, our thinking will really, of course, give the kind of outlook we have towards life, towards the words of God, towards the assignment that we have, towards this life itself. Because see, thinking is everything in life. Because our thinking produces our attitude towards life. And attitude is 100% of all that we do. Attitude is everything in life. All that we do is all about what we look at, how we look at it, the attitude we have towards it. And let me close with this just good point. In our thinking, brethren, if we are really going to enjoy life, let us form an habit of thankfulness. Let us be grateful to God. You have all opportunity to be the best that God wants you to be. Honestly speaking, you have all the opportunity to be the best that God wants you to be. Be grateful to God. Thank God for what you have. Don't focus more on what you don't have yet. Because He's a good God. If you can make your thinking straight with Him, He will help you to overcome all the obstacles you may have in life. He will help you. He will see you through. Because He's able to do it. Look at Psalm 34 from verse 1 to 3. Psalm 34 from verse 1 to 3. Praise the Lord at all times. This will be what will be going on in our heart. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. If the praise of God is in your mouth, it means the praise of God is in your thinking. You are thanking God. You are grateful to the day. You appreciate the life that God has given you. I'm telling you, you appreciate the life. The best of the best, they are gone. It's opportunity. Look at verse 2. Say, my soul shall make its boast in the Lord. Our soul should be boasting that we are Christians and we are going to be the best. We are going to influence our environment. We are going to do, we are going to shed the light. We are going to show to the world that our King reigns. That's what we're supposed to do. The psalmist said, my soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. And let us exalt His name together. This is what we should be doing. Take a great decision of being grateful at all times. Have that pattern of thinking. Are you here with me? It will make you to have a healthy lifestyle when you have that decision to be grateful all the time. For what you have, be grateful. For what you don't have, be thankful to God. Because He that did that one can do the one you need. He will do it as man think. It will help you to focus on what you have and not what you don't have if you can have the mind and the thinking of gratitude. It will help you to focus on what you have. And when you focus on what you have and not what you don't have, then you'll be able to enjoy life, then your thinking will be straight, will be based on God's word. You know what? Let me tell you this one. Whatever you have today is not your entitlement. Are you with me? Whatever you have is not your entitlement. If God answered your prayer, it's not your right. Because He can decide not to answer you. I have told you, God can say yes, He can say no, He can say wait. He does whatever He wants to do.
Sure.
Do not take it as a right. Yeah, why not? I have to be rich. In my family, they are rich. Where will I say I get my own from? Oh, what you have now is not your right, it's an opportunity. Check the scripture with me, Romans chapter 9, verse 15 to 16. I'm soon going to close. Romans chapter 9 from verse 15. Romans 9. I will have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. So there is not of evil wills, nor of evil wrongs, but of God who shows mercy. It's not because we are smart, it's not because we are intelligent, it's not because you are strong, it's not because you are from good home or you are from bad home, you are from good country or you are from wrong country. It's God's mercy and grace over your life. So what you have is not your life. It's God's opportunity, it's a privilege, it's by His mercy and His grace that we are not consumed. Hello, are you with me today? So let us have the heart of gratitude towards God. Finally, this is to be very careful, this is the last one. Train yourself to always have positive expectations. So when we talk about thinking that as man thinks, train yourself. I told you, it's by training. It's not by trying. Don't try. Train yourself to have always having positive what? Expectations about any issue in life. Positive expectations. Train yourself. You can do it. Don't be in the group of, I cannot do it, it is not possible, who is going to live with this man is wicked, this woman is evil, this country is always this, you rule out everything. Maybe you're going to pitch your tent in the wilderness, because wherever you may be, there are always challenges. Proverbs 23 verse 18, Proverbs 23 verse 18, surely there is a hereafter, and your hope will not be cut off. There is always a hereafter. Have hope. Keep hope alive. In your thinking, keep hope alive. And listen, when you do that, when you have a positive expectations about life, your hope will not be dashed. Amen? Amen. Let me have a witness. Amen?
Amen?
Your hope will not be cut off. So when you conclude your heart, and we just think we cannot do this, it's not the best thing for any Christian. Always expect good things to happen to you. Amen?
Amen?
Always imagine yourself having good opportunities. As one thing, always think of good things happening to you in life. Always expect something good from people. And it will vibrate back. Amen?
Amen?
Always expect something good from your organization, from your business, from your country. And it will vibrate out. If you don't expect something good from your country, it's not good. A man in, I'm sorry, let me just say this and I'm going to close this message. Just last week, a man in Atlanta, somewhere in Atlanta, Georgia, is supposed to come to court for something, and he loaded his bag. He hates this country. How do you hate a country where you are born? Can you imagine that? He loaded his vehicle and he was ready to drive his vehicle to the courthouse and blow everything up. How can somebody think like that? So the first deputy he saw, he shot him. And the man replied, bam, and people were around there, they killed him. And the vehicle exploded. Mission was aborted right there. You see, some people, and they said there are thousands of them in this country. They say they hate government, they don't want to pay tax to government, they say government is evil, there should be no government. Can you imagine there's no government? So listen to me very carefully. The thinking of some people is, look, you just have to understand what I'm saying. This is very important. Look, listen, the only way there will be no government is when we do the right thing. You drive, there's light, you pass the light, you wait, the red light to stop. You don't commit crime, no police to give you ticket, no camera to get you speed. Then if that happens, there will be no lawyers, there will be no courthouse, there will be no Congress to pass law. Because you are doing the right thing, you don't kill anybody, you don't steal money. But if we still do all these things, the Ten Commandments were given not for God, but for people, so they can live in harmony, right? So that's why there was the government. But when somebody thinks in his head that there should not be government, and he will do something to put down government, you want to put down the structure. Because all government is by God. God instituted government. So you cannot go against God's rules and God's ordinances and God's commandments. So as man thinks, Let us shape our thinking to be in accordance to God's word. Don't have myopic thinking. Don't think that some people believe that there shouldn't be family. Why should there be? There shouldn't be any family. Some said, there was a time I was talking to a girl, a young lady, and she told me, I don't want to marry. I said, why? I said, I don't want to have children. And I told her, straightforward, if everybody is thinking like you, I will not come to this life. And this, if you're a girl, yes, I know it's a great work for our mothers to bring us to life. But if they all say, if they all look at 9 months, how to carry these things, how to go to labor room, how to do like this, they look at all those things and they say, oh, we sign up, we are not going to do it. Then how are we going to replenish? How are we going to multiply? How are we going to increase? You see that kind of thinking? Some think like that. So let us shape our thinking to be in accordance to God's word. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Have good expectations about life. Have good expectations about yourself, about your family, about your business, about your profession. Have good expectations. You can do it. Don't let it be in your dictionary. I cannot do it. It is hard. It is difficult. No one can do this one. I have to give up. Don't do that. You continue to move forward even when it is hard. And you can say, forward ever, backward never. Think it in your heart, and then you can do it in the open. If you can think it, you can do it. Amen. Father, we bless you, worship this afternoon. We honor you for mercy, grace. Thank you for this wonderful time that you have given us. Thank you, Lord, for this series as man thinks. Help us, Lord, to follow your instructions. Give us opportunity to be the best that you want us to be. We know that you are the only one that is perfect, but in you, we can also receive our perfection. Thank you because of your goodness. Thank you because of your righteousness. Thank you because of your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Have your way in our lives. See us through this journey. In Jesus' name we have prayed.